Welcome to QuestPoints YouTube channel, and today I'll be covering 25 important Angular interview questions with answers, with code demonstrations, with explanation. Now, this is part one of this video series, and I have also developed other parts of this. So if you are interested, what you need to do is you need to go and share this video on your LinkedIn or on your Twitter or on your Facebook, and you need to send me that link at questpond@questpond.com. I will give you a coupon code, you know, which you can use, and you can get access to the other parts of the questions as well. But for now, let us go and go through these 25 questions, right? So let us get started. What is Angular and why do we need it? Now, I would like to give a very important tip out here. This tip does not apply only for this question. It applies to all the questions, you know, which will be discussed in this video. Whenever you are giving any answer in an interview, please try to elaborate it. Please do not try to just make it one line. For example, do not just say Angular is a single page application or Angular is a UI framework. Just try to make it more elaborate, more precise. Try to convey to the interviewer that you are the right candidate for this job. So let's try to answer this question. So Angular is a JavaScript UI framework. And if you want to be very precise, you can say that Angular is a JavaScript UI binding framework, which helps you to bind your view. So normally if you see, you will have your view, which is HTML, and then you have your model, which is an object, a JavaScript object. So if you want to go and bind your view with the model, then you go and you write a lot of code in between. You write a lot of binding code in between, you know, saying that when you type on this UI, it should send the message to the model. When something changes in this model, you have to again go and update the UI. So this binding code in between, or a lot of people say that this is a view model, that's the right word. This is taken care by Angular. So Angular is a binding framework which helps you to bind your view with the model. And also a lot of people say that, you know, Angular helps you to implement the MVVM pattern. So basically this is your model, this is your view, and this is your view model, right? So some people also say that this is MVVM. Some people also say this is MVC of JavaScript. Some people say this is MVP of JavaScript, you know, so that's why, you know, a lot of people, you know, rather than getting into all these things, you know, they say that it is an MVW. This W stands for whatever, right? So we can say that Angular is a JavaScript UI framework which helps you to implement MVW architecture inside the browser. Also adding more to it, it also helps you to build single page application by using the concept of routing. It has a lot of other features as well. Like example, it has HTTP features. It has dependency injection. It has input output, you know, by which you can go and you can create your own controls and so on. So when you're answering this question, you can first emphasize that it's a binding framework. It helps you to implement the MVVM pattern inside your web application, inside your browser. And then you can also go and talk about, you know, other features, you know, which Angular has, like routing, HTTP, dependency injection, and so on. Differentiate between AngularJS versus Angular. Now, this is a very important question. Must be, it looks very simple, it looks very naive, you know, but what happens is, you know, sometimes, you know, when you and not, if you're not able to answer these questions, the interviewer feels that you have no idea of Angular, right? So must be you have worked with awesome components, you know, you have done RxJS and NgRx, you know, but then when it comes to simple questions like what are the versions of Angular, what is the difference, you are not able to answer them, it sends a very wrong message to the interviewer, right? So first thing, what I've seen, you know, in the market out there, whenever they refer the old Angular, they say AngularJS. And whenever they refer the new Angular version, they say Angular. So remember that whenever the interviewer says AngularJS, he means by Angular 1 family. So we have the old Angular, you know, which has Angular 1.1, 1.2, 1.5. So that is the old AngularJS. And the new Angular, which has Angular 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And the recent version is 9, which is now having IV. So this is the new Angular. So when the interviewer says Angular, he means by the new Angular family, the Angular 2.x family. And when he says Angular JS, he means by the old family Angular 1. So what's the difference between the old Angular and the new Angular? The first thing is the language. In the old Angular, we were using JavaScript, and it is great language, but the problem is that you need to know a lot of details of how to use JavaScript, how to create closures, iffy. That's where we have TypeScript now. So TypeScript finally compiles into JavaScript, but really it increases your productivity. So the first thing I feel is the language. The second thing is the architecture. In case of Angular 1, we had the controller, the view and the model, the same kind of architecture, but therein the first, the view was loaded and then that used to load the controller. But if you look at Angular, the new Angular architecture, it is more component based. So basically the component has a template URL and he invokes the view, he talks with the model, he loads the CSS. So here the component really becomes the central point. So this is a controller based architecture while this is a component based architecture. Mobile compliant, I feel this is a very important point. In AngularJS, if you see, to make it mobile compliant, it was very difficult. And if you look at Angular, I can, it is completely mobile compliant. I can go and I can use Angular with frameworks like Ionic and make an awesome web application, awesome mobile application. So yes, mobile compliant, AngularJS is not mobile compliant, but in case of Angular, it is mobile compliant. CLI, Angular has CLI. So if you want to go and create a project template, you have to just say ng new, makes your life easy. But in case of AngularJS, we really did not have a CLI. So we have to build things from scratch. Lazy loading. Again, I find this point to be very important. In AngularJS, you know, we did not have, any kind of mechanism, you know, where we can go and we can build into small pieces of bundles, right? But, you know, thanks to the Angular build engine, in case of Angular, we can go and we can build into small bundle sizes and do lazy loading. SEO, yes. So in AngularJS is not really SEO friendly. In case of Angular, it is SEO friendly. Why? Because Angular can run on server side as well, while AngularJS cannot run on server side. So when you can run on server side, you can really make SEO friendly websites, you know, create URLs which are awesome, which the search engine understands. So these are some of the important points. Now, I would like to emphasize here that this question can be very stretchy. In other words, there are so many points around there of between AngularJS and Angular. I would suggest that pick your 3 or 4 points and speak with the interviewer. So you don't have to really speak all the points. I have given you enough points to start with, but I would say that keep this answer small. Don't make it lengthy. Like if I'm in an Angular interview, I would emphasize on the language. I would emphasize on the architecture. I would emphasize on the CLI, the mobile compliant. Other things, it's okay, right? So try to make the answer small, precise, and to the point. What are directives in Angular? Directives help you to attach behavior to your HTML DOM. Or in simplified words, I can say that directives are Angular syntaxes, you know, which you write inside HTML. For example, you can see on your HTML code out here, you know, there are a couple of directive syntaxes. For example, you know, this one ng model out here is a directive. This hidden is a directive. Even I can say the value is a directive. So if you look at a simple HTML text box, it has no behavior really. But the time I put this ng model out here, this text box now will start binding to your model. So for example, you can see here when I put this ng model out here, so whenever something is typed in this text box, it will go to the model and set the value property, right? So you can see the value out here, and something changes in this value, it will go back to this directive of the curly brackets. You can also see one more directive out here, hidden. So the time, you know, this hide function, you know, sends true and false depending on this, on that, you know, this div tag will be shown or not shown. So directives are nothing but, you know, they are Angular syntaxes inside HTML, which go and change the behavior of your HTML DOM. What are the different kind of directives in Angular? And explain each one of these directives. There are 3 kinds of directives in Angular. The first one is the structural directive. The second one is an attribute directive. And third one is a component directive. If you want to just remember this in the interview, you can remember the word, or I'll say the acronym SAC, SAC. So S stands for structural, A stands for attribute directive, and C stands for component directive. So let us try to understand each one of them. Structural directive change the structure of the DOM elements. In other words, they add a new element in the DOM or they remove an element in the DOM. So structural directives actually change the structure of the HTML DOM. For example, you can see on the screen, you know, we have a structural directive here called as ng4. So when this ng4 loop will run, depending on, you know, how many rows you have in this sales objects, you can have 10 TRs or you can have 10,000 TRs, right? So this is a structural directive. Why? Because depending on the number of rows, the TR can be added more or can be added less. So structural directives actually go and change the structure of your HTML DOM. The second category of directive is the attribute directive. An attribute directive does not add elements or remove elements. It does not change the structure of it, but it changes the behavior, the look and feel of that element. For example, you can see that this is a div tag out here. So this div tag will be hidden or shown depending on, you know, if this hide function gives a true and false. But, you know, this div tag is not removed as such. It is just made hidden, or it is not hidden, right? But it is not removed from the HTML DOM. So attribute directives do not change the structure of the HTML DOM, but rather they change the behavior of the element, like changing the color, changing it from visible true to visible false, probably, you know, making it enabled and disabled. The last kind of directive we have is the component directive. A component directive, you can think about in simple words, is nothing but a user control, a customized user control. For example, you can see on my code out here, I have a grid. I have created my own grid here called as my grid. So I can just go ahead and put this my grid out here, give some data to it, and it will actually go and display my grid. So this my grid has its own UI. It has its own template. And, you know, to create a component, you need to go and use this component decorator here, right? So a component directive is nothing but like kind of a user control which has its own template. So we have first is the structural directive, which changes the structure of the UI, which changes the structure of the HTML DOM. Then we have the attribute directive, which does not really change the structure, but it changes the look and feel. It will make it hide and false. It will disable and enable and so on. And the last one is a component directive, you know, which is nothing but like a kind of a self-contained control, you know, which has its own UI, which has its own code. What exactly is NPM and what is the use of a node_modules folder? NPM stands for Node Package Manager. NPM helps you to install any JavaScript framework in your computer. So for example, let us say that you want to go and install jQuery, then you can go and you can say here npm install jQuery, and then this jQuery will be downloaded from GitHub. So you can see here it is going and it is downloading jQuery from the GitHub, and it will copy the whole jQuery inside this folder here called as node_module. So you can see at the left hand side, there is a folder here called as node_modules. If you go out here, somewhere down below, you will have jQuery installed or jQuery copied. jQuery. So there it is, right? So quickly answering, NPM stands for Node Package Manager. And if you want to go and install anything, then you have to say here npm install jQuery. So that's the command for it. And then once you know the jQuery is downloaded from the GitHub, it gets copied into a folder, into a local folder, or sometimes also into a global folder called as node_module. So node_modules is nothing but it's a folder where your JavaScript packages are installed. What exactly is the importance of package.json file? Package.json file is a file where all the references of JavaScript frameworks are listed down. So you can see here, this is the package.json file. And in this, you know, we have Angular Common, Angular Core, Angular Forms. We are using jQuery. So whatever JavaScript frameworks you are using in your project is all listed into the package.json file. When you say it's an Angular interview, and if you are not asked TypeScript questions, then I doubt, you know, it's an Angular interview. Why? Because the The complete Angular is made in TypeScript, so some questions around TypeScript is expected. So what is TypeScript? You know, TypeScript, as the name says, TypeScript, it adds types to JavaScript. So TypeScript is a superset of JavaScript. You can go and you can write your code in TypeScript language, but at the end of the day, it will convert to JavaScript. So you can see here, I have opened their homepage, typescriptlang.org. It says that TypeScript extends JavaScript by adding types to the language. So it's a superset of JavaScript. In other words, for example, when you're writing something in my.js, you know, you can see this is on my VS Code. I have opened up my.js. So in my.js, I can go and I can say where x is equal to 0, and then I can go down and say x plus plus, and then I can go and say x is equal to shiv, and no one complains, right? That JavaScript does not complain. Why? Because JavaScript is not a typed language. And because of this, you can get errors. But in case of TypeScript, you know, it's typed. So over here, if I go and say where x, I can go and I can define a type number, you can see. So x number, and I can say 0. Now, I can go and I can do all the, what do you call, you know, the numerical operations on x1. But if I try to go and assign to x1 any kind of text, it will actually give me a compile time error saying that shiv is not assignable to the type number. So, you know, TypeScript, what it does is it actually extends JavaScript and it adds types to the JavaScript language. So it tries to make JavaScript strongly typed. One more important thing about TypeScript is that it gives you a nice object-oriented programming environment so that you can do your development faster, you can be more organized. For example, if you look at JavaScript, you know, you have to think in terms of function. So you have to say, okay, function add and then function subtract and so on. Because JavaScript is a prototypical functional programming language. But now what you can do in TypeScript is you can go and you can write a class. So example, you can say class customer, and then you can go and you can write an interface. You can go and you can extend classes. So you can say customer child extends customer and so on. So TypeScript, you know, provides a nice object oriented environment, you know, and with that, you know, your development becomes easy. So if you look around, you have most of the developers which you see around, for example, people come from C# background, people come from Java background. They are mostly object oriented programmers. So for them to go and start thinking in terms of functional programming language, it becomes very difficult. So I think one of the biggest benefit of TypeScript, which I feel personally when I worked in projects, is that TypeScript provides object-oriented environment, right? You know, which finally gets converted to JavaScript. So in other words, finally at the end of the day, this actually gets converted to JavaScript, you know. So when you go and you say tsc_sum.ts, it will get converted to JS. So you can see here I've ran the compiler, so it gets converted to JS, right? But if you see the output of this JS, that's so complex to write, isn't it? So I think this is one more big benefit of TypeScript. It provides an object-oriented programming environment, you know, which speeds up your development. So how should we answer in the interview? Well, in the interview, what we can say is that TypeScript is a superset of JavaScript, first point. The second point is TypeScript adds types to JavaScript. So in other words, it tries to make JavaScript strongly typed language, and definitely it helps you to speed up your development, you know, by providing this nice object-oriented programming environment, you know, which can speed up your development, right? So when you're asked about TypeScript, please try to put these sentences ahead. What exactly is an Angular CLI and why do we need it? So Angular CLI, the CLI, this word stands for command line interface. CLI helps you to go and create a ready-made Angular project template. So rather than starting from scratch, you can go and use the CLI and you will get a ready-made project template to kickstart with. So to install the CLI, you have to say npm install @angular/CLI. So you need to use npm to install the CLI. And once the CLI is installed, then you can go and you can say that, go and create some app called as my app. So you can see here, I'm using the syntax ng-new my app. And then what this command will do is, this command will go and it will create a project template. So you can see here it has created a project template with some base source code, with all the package.json file, all the tsconfig file, and also you can see it has started installing the node_modules folder. You can also see that he has also given you a ready-made template. So Angular CLI helps you to create a scaffold project, a ready-made template, so that rather than starting from scratch, you can start from some base code. So that helps you to increase productivity, because you are not going to go and start from scratch and start doing things manually. What exactly is a component and module in Angular? So as we have already said that, you know, Angular is a binding framework. So basically it helps you to bind your view and model very easily. This binding code, you know, which goes and binds the view and model in between, is termed as a component. So this component is like a mediator. It is like a central point which goes and binds the view and the model. It can go and bind CSS and lots of other things. Now, in a large enterprise application, you can have a lot of views, you can have a lot of components, you can have a lot of modules. So you can go and you can group a component into something called as a module. So a module groups Angular components. So just answering that question, component, you know, helps you to bind the view and the model. So component is a place in Angular where you go and you write that binding code, while module goes and groups components. Explain the importance of decorator in Angular. A decorator says to Angular that what kind of class is this. For example, if you want to go and create a component in Angular, then you need to go and use the decorator @component. You can see that this decorator here @component, which is decorated on the top of this class called a sales component. So if this decorator was not existing, if this decorator is not there, then there is no way anyone can say that this sales component class is an Angular component. And now look at this second code out here. This code here says that this sales module class is an Angular module. So if this @ng_module is not put on the top of this sales module class, then this class just becomes a simple TypeScript class. So a decorator says to Angular that what exactly is the type of this class. Now remember that this question can be questioned in a different way, that how to go and create a module and a component in Angular. So I have seen a variation of this question as well in the interview. So if somebody asks you that question, then say that to create a module in Angular, we have to use something called as @ng_module decorator. And if you want to go and create a component, then you have to use @component_decorator. So a decorator says that what kind of class is this to the Angular framework. Some developer also term decorators as annotations or metadata. So do not be surprised if the interviewer asks you the previous question with a slight different way, like what is metadata or what is annotations or what is data annotation. The answer remains absolutely same. So whatever answer we have answered for decorator, the same answer holds true when you are asked for metadata and annotations. What are templates in Angular? Templates are nothing but it's an HTML view of Angular. So you can see here this is a template URL, and it is pointing towards an HTML. And in this HTML view, we can go and we can write Angular syntaxes or Angular directives like expressions. You can go and use pipes. You can go and use directives like form group, ng_model, and so on. And there are two ways of defining a template. One is you can define it inline. So in other words, you can go here to this component decorator and you can say template, and you can define it right inside your component code. So this is an inline template. Or you can go and you can have a different physical file and you can then connect to the template. So you can see the template URL. The template URL is pointing towards an HTML. So this is again a template. So there are two ways of defining a template. One is inline, where you can go and you can write HTML right inside the TypeScript code. Or second is you can go and you can define a separate physical file like custapp.component.html, and then you can link it by using this @componentDecorator in your TypeScript code. What are the different types of data binding in Angular? Now, before we answer that question, let us try to define what exactly is data binding. Data binding in Angular defines, you know, how the view and component communicate with each other. So that's what exactly data binding is all about. So let us start with the different kinds of data binding. The first one is an expression, or you can also term it as an interpolation. So where expression binding or an interpolation binding, in this case what happens is the data flows from the controller to the view, but then you know you can mix that data inside HTML. So for example, you can see out here this is a customer name, but how smoothly it is mixing with the TD tag. Look at this expression again out here, customer ID, which is getting mixed with the BR tag. So interpolation or expression is nothing but, you know, wherein the data flows from the controller to the view, and then you can go and you can stick that data inside, stick or I'll say mix, whatever word you want to use, inside HTML. The second kind of data binding is the property binding. So you can look at this square bracket out here. So in this case, you know, again the data flows from the controller to the view, but then it gets attached to some user input like a text box. So you can see this ng model out here. In this case, you know, the customer ID data can flow from the controller to the view. So whenever some change happens in the component, in the customer ID, the data will be replicated onto the view and displayed inside a text box. So this is termed as a property binding. This is termed as an expression, or I can say an interpolation binding. The third kind of binding what we have here is the event binding. Event means, you know, let's say when somebody clicks on a button or somebody goes and or something, you want to track some event, you know, from the view to the component, or you want to send some event from the view to the component, that's where we have event binding. So in case of event binding, we use the round bracket. So you can see the click. A click event will go from the view to the component. So this is termed as an event binding. And then finally, the last one is termed as a two-way binding. For example, over here, if you see, I'm using both of them. I'm using the square bracket as well as round bracket. So in this case, you know, what will happen is, you know, you can send the data from the controller to the view. Also, you know, if some event happens, then that will also go from the view to the component. So in this case, it is a two-way binding, right? So there are four kinds of data binding. One is the interpolation, the expression, which gets mixed with HTML. Second one is this square bracket, you know, where the data flows from the component to the view. Then we have the round bracket, which is the event binding, which flows from the view to the component. And then we have the two-way binding, you know, where, you know, the data or the events can flow to and fro, you know, from the view to the component and from component to the view. Explain the architecture of Angular, or explain the important pillars which comprises the Angular architecture, or explain the different blocks which are present in Angular. Now remember that whenever you are going for interviews, I would really suggest to carry a paper and a pen, or a notepad and a pen. Why? You know, because when you are answering some very complicated answer, I would suggest to draw diagrams. Remember that if you are serious about a job, you should really try to impress the interviewer. Stand out from the crowd. So when you go for interviews, you will find a lot of crowd out there. Stand out from the crowd, you know, by drawing diagrams, by explaining in a looked manner, by explaining proper technical vocabularies and so on. So let us try to answer this, you know, by drawing a diagram. So when you talk about the architecture in Angular, there are like 7 or 8 important components, you know, which you should discuss about. So the first thing, you know, is the template, right? So the first important component in Angular is the template. A template is nothing but the view, right? Actually, the HTML view. So this template is the HTML view. So this is the first thing. Let me mark this first. Now, this view talks with a component. So that's the next thing. So the next important pillar in Angular architecture is a component. A group of component is then logically put into modules. So the third important thing which you should discuss in your answer is modules. Now, the binding between the view and the components are done by the bindings. So you have the square bracket, you have the round bracket. So the round bracket is it sends, you know, events from view to the component. The square bracket, you know, sends from the component to the view. So the next important thing which you should really discuss about is binding. So that's the fourth thing. The fifth thing is the directives. So inside the view, you know, we have different directives like interpolation. We can have ng model. We can have click and so on. So the fifth point is directives. Now in a project, you always want to share common logic, or you have some common things, you know, which you want to share. So for that, we need to go and create a service. So the sixth thing, you know, which you should discuss, you know, when you're talking about Angular is the service. Now this service, you know, when it is consumed inside components, it is actually not, the object is not created, it is injected. So when you have services, you know, which you want to go and put across all the components, then we use something called as dependency injection, right? The injector. So the seventh thing, you know, which you should discuss about is dependency injection. So when you're talking about the Angular architecture, I would suggest to talk about these seven things. First is the template, which is the view. The view talks with the component, right? So this component is actually for binding. This component talks with CSS. It talks with the model. Then the third thing is, where is the third thing? The third thing is the module. So module groups the components. The fourth thing is the binding, you know, which says that how the data will flow from the view to the component. Then the fifth thing is the directives. So directives, you know, they help you to go and change the DOM behavior. The sixth thing is the service, which is a common logic which you want to go and inject all across your project. For example, common logic can be validation, it can be logging utility, it can be HTTP services and so on. And that is done via the dependency injection. So that's the seventh thing. So when you're discussing this answer with the interviewer, I would really say that try to draw the diagram and try to emphasize these seven important points. Explain the term SPA. SPA stands for single page application. Single page application is a concept, you know, wherein we load the UI once and then we don't reload it again and again. For example, you know, when you talk about a typical website will have a left menu, it can have a footer, it can have a banner. So you can have a banner, a logo out here, then you can have a footer out here, copyright and so on. You can have a left menu and so on. So in single page application, what happens is these sections are loaded only once, right? So the left menu, the footer, etc. These sections will be loaded only once. But then when an end user goes and clicks on any hyperlink of the left menu, then only that section, the necessary UI will be loaded from the server. So by this, you will get, you know, performance improvement, right? So single page application is a concept, you know, wherein we have a single page, and in that page, whatever is the necessary UI, it is loaded only once. The common UI is loaded once. And then, you know, depending on what the end user clicks or the end user wants to see, you know, at that time, only the necessary UI is loaded. How do we implement single page application using Angular? To implement single page application using Angular, we need to use something called as the Angular routing. Now, but obvious, the connected question is, what exactly is routing in Angular and how do you actually implement it? So routing is nothing but it is a very simple collection in Angular, and the main goal of routing is to define the navigation of your Angular application. So if you look at any routing collection, for example, you can see here I have a home routes. It has two things. One is it has a URL, and then this URL says that where you will be navigating. For example, if somebody hits the login, it will go to the login component and the login component will invoke the login view. If you go and navigate to home URL, it will go to the home component and it will load the home page. So routing helps you to define the navigation of your application, and it has two things. One is it has a URL and what exactly that URL will load. So how exactly is routing implemented in Angular? So the first step for routing is that you need to go and define a collection. And you need to say that for which URL, which component will be loaded. So you can see here, I'm saying for the login, when somebody goes and tries to navigate to login, it will load the login component. When somebody will try to navigate to home, it will load the home component. Then in your HTML, you need to go and define something called as a router outlet. This router outlet is a place, you know, where your page will be loaded. And you also need to go and define something called as a router link. So you can see here, I'm saying router link and I'm saying home. So when somebody goes and clicks on this home, it will first go to this collection and say, okay, home. So for home, what do we have? We have the home component. And then it will go and it will load this home.html inside this router outlet. So when I click on customer/add this route, it will go and load the customer page inside the router outlet. So to implement routing, we need three things. First is we need the collection saying that which URL will go to which component. Second one is we need to have the router outlet, you know, where exactly that navigation, that page will load. And we need to go and define our router link in case of HTML and say the URL name. If you want to go and do routing from the code behind, or if you want to do routing from your component, then you need to go and say router.navigate. So if you want to go and do routing from the HTML, then you will use router link in your anchor tag or in your button, wherever you want. But if you want to do it from the component, then you need to say this.route.navigate and the URL. What exactly is lazy loading in Angular? Lazy loading means on-demand loading, or loading what is essential and necessary. For example, you can see that this is a dummy website I have here. So when I go and load this website, you can see that it has loaded certain JS files, but he has not loaded still my customer user interface. So when I click on customer, only at that time it will go and load the customer JS. So you can see right out here, when I now click on customer, now it goes and loads the customer JS. But in the first go when I came in, when the first time when I logged in, it did not load the customer module. So lazy loading means on demand loading, loading only what is necessary and loading only what the user wants at that moment. How can we implement lazy loading in Angular? If you want to go and implement lazy loading in Angular, you need to do at least two things. The first thing is you need to go and divide your project into separate modules. If that is not there, lazy loading is not possible. For example, you can see over here, I have divided my project into a customer module. So you can see I have a customer module. Then I also have a home module. You can see there's a home module. So the first step is you need to go and divide your project into separate modules. And then the module which you want to do lazy loading, you need to use the load children in your routes collection. So you can see here, this is load children and it says load this customer module on demand or on the fly. So two things you need to do. You need to use load children and you need to go and divide your project into modules. What are services in Angular? Now, when you talk about big enterprise application, you can have view, you can have components, you can have a lot of views, you can have a lot of components, lot of models. So, and you can have multiple modules. So think about it. Here you can see on your screen that this is one module which is grouping multiple components. Then you can have another module which actually again groups some other components. Right now, let us say you want to go and share common functionality across the whole project, right? So you want to go and share common functionality, you know, at this module, on this module, so that it goes to the components down below and to the models and the views down below. So for that, you know, we need to go and create a service. So if you want to go and share common functionality across your modules, you will create a service. So you can go and you can create a service. So this service can be common functionality like validations. It can be logging, loggers. It can be HTTP service. And this service then can be used by this module and this module and so on. So if you want to go and share common functionality across your projects, then you will use something called as service. One of the patterns which I've noticed in Angular interviews is that once the interviewer asks you questions around services, the next question is around dependency injection. So let's try to answer this question. What exactly is dependency injection and how to implement the same using Angular? So dependency injection, you can think about it's an application design pattern wherein the class, rather than instantiating the dependencies from the class, it prefers to get injected from outside, or somebody else will instantiate and send it to the class. For example, you can see over here, we have this class here, MasterPH component, and it is trying to use this logger class for logging. So rather than going and seeing here where p base logger, so rather than going and creating an instance from here, what we have done is, in the constructor, we are telling Angular that you please inject it. So rather than going and instantiating the dependencies from the class itself, in dependency injection, Angular injects it from outside. Now the next connected question which definitely comes in is, how do we implement dependency injection in Angular? So to implement dependency injection in Angular, we need to use something called as the provider attribute. So we have this providers attribute which belongs to the ng module decorator. So if you want to create a module, we use this ng module. So in this we have the provider. So over here we will say provide. So if somebody is asking in the constructor this base logger, inject HTTP logger. So over here we will use the providers collection, and in that we will provide that for this class what instance to be injected. So just summarizing, to do dependency injection in Angular, we need to use the providers property which belongs to the ng module metadata or to the decorator. And then later on, what you can do is you can go to your component and you can say, okay, give me base logger, and Angular will inject the base logger depending on what you have provided here. The next connected question around dependency injection is, what is the benefit of using dependency injection? Now I would say that try to be very careful when you are answering this question. Why? Because different developers perceive dependency injection in different ways. But here is what I think, you know, about dependency injection. The biggest benefit of dependency injection is decoupling. Or I'll say rather that when you change at one place, you don't have to change at a lot of places. So basically, when you talk about a good software architecture, if you want to go and change something, you change at one place and it should be reflected all across your project. For example, look at this example out here, which I am showing on the video. So over here, I'm using base logger. So assume that in my application, if you see this base logger at this moment, this base logger is a base class. So we are using alert logger across the project. So whenever there is any logging of errors and warnings, it is showing it in an alert box of JavaScript. And everywhere this base logger, it injects the alert logger instance. Now let us say I want to go and change from one place, and I want to say that let's not use alert logger. Let me go and change it to HTTP logger. So what I have to do now, I have to go and change just over here in the providers. So I just go and change over here, and everywhere across my project, across my components, it will inject HTTP logger. So the biggest benefit of dependency injection is that you change at one place and the object instances are injected all across the project. You don't have to really go and say new keyword. So think about it. If I don't use dependency injection, then I have to go and say here, okay, where x base new logger is equal to HTTP logger, right? And then tomorrow someone says, oh, like, let us go and change it to alert logger. Then again, you have to go to all the components and say alert logger. So remember that one of the biggest disadvantage of instantiating the class by using the new keyword is it does tight coupling. Your class will be tightly coupled, you know, as soon as you start creating the instances within the class. But when you use dependency injection, that means now you are given this work to someone else. In this case, it is Angular, and Angular will ensure that he will inject the instance. So the biggest benefit of dependency injection is that decoupling. You change at one place and it will get reflected all across your project. What's the difference between ng serve and ng build? So normally when you're working with Angular, we have something here called as an ng serve command. So you can see you can do an ng serve like this, or you can also do something called as ng build. So what's the difference between ng serve and ng build? Ng serve builds Angular application in memory inside RAM. So whenever you are doing development, NG serve is good. But now when you want to go finally to production, or when you want to actually have the build on the hard disk, then we need to use something called as NG build. So NG build builds Angular application into the hard disk. So it actually goes and creates a dist folder. You can see there's a dist folder out here, and it goes and puts down all the binaries or whatever is the final compile code into the dist folder, while ng serve builds in memory. So ng serve builds in memory, ng build builds on the hard disk. What does the hyphen hyphen prod flag do in ng build? So if you see, normally, you know, when people go to production, they will always build by using the hyphen hyphen prod. So they will say ng build, and they will go and they will use this hyphen hyphen prod. The hyphen hyphen prod actually makes your application ready for production. So in other words, what it does is it goes and it does the minification, it removes all the unnecessary things, it removes comments, it tries to make the most compressed code or most compressed build, you know, what you want to send to your production. So you can see here I have done the ng build. So if you look at the final output of an ng hyphen build, you can see that it is a compressed JS file. It has compressed everything into a single JS file, and it has tried to minify as far as possible. So whenever you're going to production, always build with using the hyphen hyphen prod flag. So that brings us to the end of part one. Now in part two, we will go into more advanced questions, you know, like validations, how to do validations. One of the most asked questions is around the Angular lifecycle, the component lifecycle, you know, what are the important lifecycle hooks and what is the sequence of it. We will talk about HTTP components and so on. So Angular interview questions part two will be more of advanced question. So keep learning. Happy job hunting. Best of luck.